Recorded Books and RB Digital present The End of Mental Illness by Daniel G. Amen. Narrated by Richard Harries. Introduction. Why I hate the term mental illness, and you should too. From Eric Hoffer. In times of profound change, the learners inherit the earth, while the learned find themselves beautifully equipped to deal with the world that no longer exists. Stuck at a traffic light midday at the corner of Hollywood and Vine in Hollywood, California, on my way to record a podcast with storyteller and social media phenom Jay Shetty, I saw a 30-something man, about 5 feet 10 inches, with dirty blonde hair, ripped clothes, and blood on his face, talking to himself while gesturing wildly in the air. He seemed oblivious to everyone around him, and those walking on the street paid him no mind. After all, this was Hollywood and Vine. Most of my colleagues would have diagnosed him with schizophrenia or unstable bipolar disorder and wondered why he wasn't taking his medication to help the voices and visions stay away. When I saw him, I wondered when he'd had his last brain injury, if he had been exposed to mold or environmental toxins, if he suffered with severe gut health issues, or whether he had had an infectious disease like Lyme or toxoplasmosis ravaging his brain. We are on the cusp of a new revolution that will change mental health care forever. The end of mental illness discards an outdated, stigmatized paradigm that taints people with disparaging labels, preventing them from getting the help they need, and replaces it with a modern brain-based whole-person program rooted in neuroscience and hope. No one is shamed for cancer, diabetes, or heart disease, even though they have significant lifestyle contributions. Likewise, no one should be shamed for depression, panic disorders, bipolar disorder, addictions, schizophrenia, and other brain health issues. Over the last 30 years, my colleagues and I have built the world's largest database of brain scans related to behavior. We have performed more than 160,000 brain SPECT, single photon emission computed tomography scans, which measure blood flow and activity patterns, and over 10,000 QEEGs, quantitative electroencephalograms, which measure electrical activity on patients from 9 months old to 105 years from 121 countries. Our brain imaging work has completely disrupted how we help our patients get well, and this information can help you, even if no one ever looks at your brain. The human brain is an organ, just like your heart and all your other organs, and you can only be as mentally healthy as your brain is functionally healthy. It has become crystal clear to us that as psychiatrists, we are not dealing with mental health issues, but we are dealing with brain health issues. And this one idea has changed everything we do to help our patients. We are not dealing with mental health issues, but we are dealing with brain health issues. And this one idea has changed everything. I have come to hate the terms mental illness and psychiatric disorders, and you should too. They place emphasis in the wrong domain, the mind or the psyche, when our imaging work teaches us that we must first focus on the brain. Mental illness and psychiatric disorders conjure up stigmatizing images of lunacy in people who are mad, disturbed, unbalanced, or unstable, even though these adjectives apply to an extremely small percentage of people who struggle with brain health / mental health issues. Being diagnosed with a mental illness or a psychiatric disorder insidiously taints or stains everyone who struggles with perceived issues of the mind, making them less likely to ever want to seek help for fear they'll be diminished in the eyes of others. Just look at what happened to 1972 vice presidential nominee Thomas Eagleton. The up-and-coming senator from Missouri, who had been the show-me state's youngest ever attorney general, a devout Catholic and a fiery opponent to the Vietnam War, was tapped to be presidential candidate George McGovern's running mate and was considered a perfect choice. But when it was discovered that he had been treated for depression, he was asked to step down from McGovern's political ticket only 18 days after his nomination. Ever since this dark national memory, mental health issues have been considered lethal in political circles. Yet according to biographer Joshua Wolf Schenck, Abraham Lincoln fought clinical depression all his life, and if he were alive today, his condition would have been treated as a character issue, that is, as a political liability. His condition was indeed a character issue. It gave him the tools to save the nation. Schenck argues that because of depression, Lincoln knew how to suffer and how to rise above his bad feelings in difficult times. Of note, Lincoln had a serious head injury at age 10 when he was kicked in the head by a horse and left unconscious. You will see that head injuries are a common and often overlooked cause of emotional and behavioral problems. Lincoln's depression was indeed a character issue. It gave him the tools to save the nation. By labeling these issues as mental health or psychiatric instead of brain health, people suffer in silence because of the shame they feel. Consider the rash of celebrity suicides and deaths by overdose of people who were too embarrassed or ashamed to ask for help, from Ernest Hemingway, Judy Garland, Junior Seau, to Robin Williams, Mindy McCready, Philip Seymour Hoffman, Anthony Bourdain, and Kate Spade. On the outside, they seemed as if they had everything. On the inside, they were suffering. If we do not erase or at least lower the stigma for these brain health issues, many more people will unnecessarily suffer and die without getting the help they need. We must do better because about every 14 minutes, someone dies by suicide in the United States. Suicide is the 10th leading cause of death overall and the second leading cause of death for those 10 to 34 years of age. Since 1999, suicide has increased 33%, decreasing overall life expectancy, while during the same period of time, cancer has decreased 27%. The last time America experienced a decrease in life expectancy was in the early 20th century, when the Spanish influenza and World War I killed nearly 1 million people. I've been surrounded by suicide, with an aunt who killed herself, as did my adopted son's biological father, and my son-in-law's father. The pain of suicide is unlike any other loss, because people see it as a choice rather than as a consequence of an illness. Every 8 minutes, someone dies of a drug overdose, and the recent opiate crisis in America is only getting worse year after year. In 2017, there were more than 70,000 drug overdoses, with 67% of them from opiates, an increase of 45% from 2016. In 2017, teens and young adults in the United States were more prone to depression, distress, and suicide compared with millennials when they were the same age. 36% of girls will experience clinical depression during their teenage years, compared to 13% of teenage boys. Both numbers are unacceptable. 23% of women between the ages of 40 and 59 are taking antidepressant medication. According to a large epidemiological study, 50% of the U.S. population will struggle with a mental health issue at some point in their lives. Anxiety disorders, 28%, depression, 21%, impulse control disorders, 25%, and substance use disorders, 15%, are the most common. Half of all cases start by age 14, and 75% start by age 24. According to the World Health Organization, 25% of all health-related disability is due to mental health and substance use conditions, 8 times more than disability caused by heart disease and 40 times more than cancer. Shame holds people back from getting the help they need. No one is shamed for cancer, diabetes, or heart disease. Likewise, no one should be shamed for depression, panic disorders, bipolar disorder, and other brain health issues. Even though I have loved being a psychiatrist for the past 40 years, I am not a fan of my professional label because psychiatrists are often dismissed as unscientific and scorned by other medical professionals and the general public. In 1980, when I told my father, a highly intelligent and successful entrepreneur, that I wanted to be a psychiatrist, he asked me, "Why didn't you want to be a real doctor? Why do you want to be a nut doctor and hang out with nuts all day long?" At the time, his words upset me, but 40 years later, I have a deeper understanding of why he was concerned. In a similar vein, I've heard countless patients say, "I'm not going to see a psychiatrist because I'm not crazy." Stigma reigns. I prefer the term clinical neuroscientist to psychiatrist. Reimagining mental health as brain health changes everything. Early in my career, I learned that very few people want to see a psychiatrist. No one wants to be labeled as defective or abnormal, but once people learn about the importance of their brain, everyone wants a better one. What if mental health was brain health? That is what the brain imaging work we are doing at Amen Clinics teaches us daily. Think of it this way. Your brains can have problems just as your heart can have problems. Most people who see cardiologists, however, have never had a heart attack. They are there because they have risk factors, a family history of heart disease, high blood pressure, or too much abdominal fat, and they want to prevent a heart attack. To end mental illness, we must develop a similar way of thinking. Reframing the discussion from mental health to brain health changes everything. People begin to see their problems as medical, not moral. It decreases shame and guilt and increases forgiveness and compassion from their families. Reframing the discussion to brain health is also more accurate and elevates hope, increases the desire to get help, and increases compliance to make the necessary lifestyle changes. Once people understand that the brain controls everything they do and everything they are, they want a better brain so they can have a better life. Reframing the discussion from mental health to brain health changes everything. People see their problems as medical, not moral. It decreases stigma, shame, and guilt. It increases compassion and forgiveness from families. It is a more accurate description of the biology involved. It elevates hope. It increases compliance with treatment plans. The end of mental illness will give you a completely new way to think about and treat brain health / mental health issues, such as anxiety, depression, bipolar disorders, attention deficit disorder / attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADD / ADHD, addictions, obsessive compulsive disorder, OCD, post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD, schizophrenia, and even personality disorders. It is based on a very simple premise. Get your brain right, and your mind will follow. In study after study, improving the physical functioning of the brain improves the mind. Your brain's history is not your destiny. The reason I dedicated this book to my two nieces, Alize, 15, and Amelie, 10, is that they were born into a family plagued by mental illness, multiple suicides, major depression, schizophrenia, drug abuse, manic depressive behavior, OCD, anxiety and panic disorders, ADD/ADHD, body dysmorphia, and criminal behavior. Their genetic vulnerability for mental illness was incredibly high from before birth. In addition, they were born into chaos with parents who struggled with addictions, depression, and behavioral issues. In 2016, Child Protective Services, who deemed they were living in a dangerous situation, took them from their parents. The two girls still vividly remember the panic and horror of police taking them from their mother. At the time, my wife, Tana, was estranged from her half-sister, Tamara, the girl's mother. But when we found out that the children were taken into foster care, we knew we must act. We wrapped brain health / mental health services around Tamara. At the time, the father refused to get help, and she was able to gain control over her addiction, depression, ADHD, and past head trauma, 19 car accidents. Thanks to this progress, she was reunited with her children on Mother's Day 2017. Since that time, using the principles in this book, Tamara, Alize, and Amelie have thrived. Like all people who experience this type of chaos, they have had ups and downs. But Tamara is gainfully employed at a job she loves, and the girls are both A students, happy, social, and purposeful. At the time of this writing, Alize is an honor society student and participates in cross-country and track and field. In the last year, she has been awarded language arts, life science, and automation and robotics student of the year. Tana, Tamara, and I are committed to ending the cycle of mental illness in the girls as well as in their future children and grandchildren. This book is our blueprint. It is your blueprint, too. The end of mental illness starts with you and the people close to you. This book is your blueprint. Part 1 will briefly introduce you to the history of psychiatry and mental health treatment. To illustrate this, I will reveal some of the surprising and downright shocking ways that one of my patients, Jarrett, would have been treated throughout the ages. I'll help you reframe mental illness. We'll discard an outdated diagnostic paradigm based solely on symptom clusters and replace it with a brain-centered paradigm based on symptoms plus neuroimaging, genetics, and a personalized medicine approach to brain/body health. Then I'll share the 12 major lessons we've learned from our brain imaging work that completely change the way we think about and help our patients. You will be introduced to the Amen Clinic's Four Circles Bright Minds program to end mental illness, which reveals the simple yet very powerful concept that in order to have a healthy mind, you must first have a healthy brain. To do that, you must optimize the four circles of a whole life: biological, psychological, social, and spiritual, as well as prevent or treat the 11 major risk factors that damage the brain and steal your mind. In part 2, you will learn how to create or eliminate mental illnesses. If you know how they're created, you will have the prescriptions to avoid and treat them. Here you'll discover the enormous impact that modern society has had on the exploding brain health / mental health crisis in America. This section will also explore the 11 bright minds risk factors that steal your mind and show you how to avoid them. I wrote about these risk factors extensively in my book Memory Rescue, but only as they relate to memory. These same factors greatly influence other brain health / mental health problems. Bright minds stands for blood flow, retirement / aging, inflammation, genetics, head trauma, toxins, mind storms, abnormal brain electrical activity, immunity / infections, neurohormone issues, diabetes, sleep. As you will see, once you reduce your risk factors, your brain and mind will be healthier. In part 3, I'll share many practical strategies on how to boost your brain and optimize your mind, including how to think about psychiatric medicines versus nutritional supplements, nutraceuticals, the most important health numbers to check every year, and the critical importance of your food. In addition, the final chapter summarizes the strategies on how to create and end mental illness. Bright Minds Tip: get your brain right, and your mind will follow. It's time to get the help you need by discarding an outdated, stigmatizing, unscientific paradigm. Here's an example of why we need to discard the current outdated paradigm in favor of our new model. How Chase Eliminated His Mental Illness by Healing His Brain. Chase was a smart, successful young man, fresh out of college with a great job, but inside he was suffering. Chase struggled with severe anxiety, uncontrollable mood swings, negative thought patterns, crippling panic attacks, a bad temper, and disrupted sleep. He had difficulty with work relationships and making friends. He couldn't talk to people and always seemed to be in a bad mood. He also lacked a clear sense of any purpose. As a teenager, he saw a psychiatrist who, after asking him to fill out a questionnaire, diagnosed Chase with bipolar disorder, a severe mood disorder in which people cycle between depression and mania, as well as ADHD, an intermittent explosive disorder, IED. Chase also had a family history of depression and addictions. Over the years, he jumped from one medication to the next, trying to find something that worked. The side effects only made things worse, and he gained more than 80 pounds. This young man, who already had social anxiety, now had even more reasons to isolate himself. Chase's brain and body finally gave up. He had a nervous breakdown and was unable to work. Chase's stepmother, Terry, suggested he come to our clinic in New York City for an evaluation. Terry's daughter had struggled with learning and anxiety attacks, but had a dramatic turnaround after coming to our clinic. That inspired Terry to visit one of our clinics, which helped her improve her own troubled brain to become a better businesswoman. Subsequently, Terry sent many other members of her family to our clinics for help. As we do with all our patients, we did a comprehensive evaluation of Chase. As part of our diagnostic process, we took a detailed history, performed neuropsychological tests, ran a lab workup — Chase had low levels of vitamin D and testosterone — and scanned his brain to assess blood flow and activity patterns in the brain. SPECT looks at how the brain works. It is different than CAT scans and MRIs, which are anatomy studies that look at the structure of the brain. SPECT looks at brain function and in my opinion is much more helpful for people with complex brain health / mental health problems, like ADD, ADHD, and bipolar disorder. You will learn much more about our work with SPECT in Chapters 2 and 3. Chase's SPECT scan showed significantly low overall blood flow to his brain, especially to his prefrontal cortex, a brain region associated with focus, forethought, judgment, planning, empathy, and impulse control, and his temporal lobes, a brain region associated with mood stability, learning, memory, and temper control. His scan was consistent with past head trauma and toxicity, which caused us to ask Chase more pointed questions to try to understand why his brain looked so troubled. It turned out that his family owned a NASCAR speedway, and Chase had been racing cars since he was a child, spending a lot of time around and breathing in toxic gasoline fumes. He'd had a number of significant concussions, including one from racing. Many people are misdiagnosed with bipolar disorder, mental illness, after they have had a significant concussion, brain illness, that affects their prefrontal cortex and temporal lobes. Bright Minds tip. Many people are misdiagnosed with bipolar disorder after they have had a significant concussion. The right diagnosis is critical to effective treatment. After seeing his scans and understanding the story of Chase's life, it was clear he did not have bipolar disorder, ADHD, and IED, but rather the long-term effects of concussions and toxic exposure to the gasoline fumes, giving him these symptom clusters. We stopped his medications, gave him brain-supportive supplements, and went to work rehabilitating his brain using the Amen Clinic's Four Circles Bright Minds program, which will be laid out in detail in upcoming chapters. As part of the program, we completely changed Chase's diet, encouraging him to only eat foods that served his brain health rather than ones that hurt it. Plus, he started exercising daily. Chase did everything we asked him. In just a few months, his confidence soared. Several months later, his brain showed significant improvement. His skin also cleared up, and he had lost 80 pounds, other signs that his brain was healthier. Now he has an even better job, where he says he has great working relationships, lots of friends outside the office, loves trying new things, and is in a committed relationship. After learning about his brain, Chase still loves watching car racing, but says he'll personally never race again. And not just because of the concussions, but also because of the toxins he was inhaling, gas, oil, burned rubber, and all the other chemicals he does not want inside his body. Chase desperately needed a radical new approach. Both his physical and mental health were going the wrong way. Chase had been given three major psychiatric diagnoses: bipolar disorder, ADHD, and IED from his psychiatrist, who used checklists and groups of related symptoms known as symptom clusters from the American Psychiatric Association's Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, DSM. And his treatment was doing him more harm than good. Yes, on the surface, it is much easier to try different medications, hoping for a quick fix, and not have to bother with changing your life. But the medications we use in psychiatry are often insidious, meaning once you start them, they are very hard to stop. They change your brain to need them in order for you to feel normal. In the long run, it is generally easier to do a bit of work to change your habits, so you need fewer medications, or in some cases, none at all. Bright Minds tip. On the surface, it's easier to try different medications, hoping for a quick fix and not have to bother with lifestyle changes. But psychiatric medications are often insidious, meaning once you start them, they are very hard to stop. They change your brain to need them in order for you to feel normal. The way we evaluated and helped Chase is very different from the typical way most people are diagnosed and treated for mental illnesses. In 2020, if you suspect you have a mental health issue, you are likely to visit a psychiatrist or primary care physician who prescribe 85% of psychiatric medications, who will ask you to describe your symptoms. In most cases, your doctor will listen, do an examination, then look for symptom clusters. Based on this, they will give you a diagnosis and treatment plan, usually involving one or more psychiatric medications. For example, if you are anxious, you usually get an anxiety disorder diagnosis and end up with a prescription for an anti-anxiety medication, which has been found in some studies to be associated with an increased incidence of dementia. If you have attention problems, you may end up with a diagnosis of ADHD and a prescription for stimulant medications such as Ritalin or Adderall. These medications can help many people, but it's important to be aware that they can also make some people worse. Or you may say, "I'm depressed." Your doctor will then label you with a diagnosis that has the same name as your symptoms, depression in this example, without taking any biological information into consideration. Treatment is typically an antidepressant medication. According to psychiatrist Thomas Insel, the former director of the National Institutes of Mental Health, NIMH, for the antidepressants, the rate of response continues to be slow and low. In the largest effectiveness study to date, with more than 4,000 patients with major depressive disorder in primary care and community settings, only 31% were in remission after 14 weeks of optimal treatment. In most double-blind trials of antidepressants, the placebo response rate hovers around 30%. The unfortunate reality is that current medications help too few people to get better and very few people to get well. This is consistent with what Insel's predecessor, Steve Hyman, former director of the NIMH, wrote in 2018. That in the last half century, we have failed to progress significantly in medications to treat psychiatric illnesses. A typical example of this outdated diagnostic method is for people who have temper problems like Chase and who explode intermittently. They often get diagnosed with IED, which is an ironic acronym. These people are often prescribed anger management classes or any number of medications. From our experience with tens of thousands of patients at Amen clinics, and after 40 years in the field, I'm convinced that making diagnoses solely based on DSM symptom clusters such as anxiety, depression, temper outbursts, or a short attention span is inadequate and disrespectful to patients. Symptoms don't tell us anything about the underlying biology of the problems our patients have. All other medical professionals look directly at the organs they treat, but psychiatrists are taught to assume what the underlying biological mechanisms are for illnesses such as depression, ADD, ADHD, bipolar disorder, and addiction, without ever looking at the brain. Even though our patients are every bit as sick as those with heart disease, diabetes, or cancer. Making diagnoses solely based on DSM symptom clusters such as anxiety, depression, temper outbursts, or a short attention span is inadequate. An explosive 2019 study in psychiatry research confirms what I've been saying for decades. Making psychiatric diagnoses based solely on symptom clusters is scientifically meaningless and disingenuous. The study, led by University of Liverpool researchers, focused on a meticulous analysis of five chapters in DSM-5: anxiety disorders, depressive disorders, trauma-related disorders, bipolar disorder, and schizophrenia. Their main findings highlight many of the shortcomings of the current diagnostic paradigm. There is a major overlap of symptoms among diagnoses. Many diagnoses overlook the role of psychological trauma and head trauma. The current approach rarely takes the individual into account. The study's deep dive into the numbers shows just how murky and inconsistent the diagnostic model is. For example, there are almost 24,000 possible symptom combinations for panic disorder in DSM-5, compared with just one possible combination for social phobia. Equally concerning is their finding that two people could receive the same diagnosis without sharing any common symptoms. And the sheer number of combinations of symptoms makes the ability to arrive at an accurate diagnosis nearly impossible. Take this stunning fact, for instance. In the DSM-5, there are 270 million combinations of symptoms that would meet the criteria for both PTSD and major depressive disorder. And when five other commonly made diagnoses are seen alongside these two, this figure rises to one quintillion symptom combinations, more than the number of stars in the Milky Way. The researchers conclude that following a different approach may be more effective than remaining committed to what they called a disingenuous categorical system. Rest assured, it doesn't have to be this way. Reframing the way we think about mental illnesses by looking at them as brain health issues is more accurate. It is this discovery that completely changed the way we approach diagnosing and treating our patients at Amen Clinics. It is also the underlying reason why Amen Clinics has one of the highest published success rates for complex patients who have failed an average of 3.3 providers and 5 medications. In fact, 84% of the complex treatment-resistant patients we treat at Amen Clinics report feeling better after 6 months. This book will share some of those stories and provide the steps to end mental illness now, not just in the lives of Alize and Amelie, but also in your own life and in the lives of your children and grandchildren. 1. Eliminate the term mental illness and replace it with the term brain health / mental health issues. 2. Discard an outdated diagnostic paradigm based solely on symptom clusters and replace it with a brain-centered paradigm based on symptoms plus neuroimaging, genetics, and a personalized medicine approach to brain/body health. Chapters 1 to 3. 3. Assess and treat whole people in 4 circles: biological, psychological, social, and spiritual. Chapter 4. 4. Prevent or treat the 11 major bright minds risk factors that damage the brain and steal the mind. Chapters 5 to 15. 5. First, do no harm. Know the science comparing mind meds versus nutraceuticals. Nutraceuticals have more scientific support than most people know and are often an evidence-based option. Chapter 16. 6. Know your important health numbers and recheck them on a yearly basis to help prevent brain health / mental health issues before they start. Chapter 17. 7. Eat foods that enhance brain health rather than those that accelerate brain/mind illnesses. Chapter 18. 8. provide brain health / mental health education in schools, businesses, churches, and anywhere people congregate. Chapter 19. Part 1. Reframing mental health as brain health changes everything. Chapter 1. From Demon Possession to the 15-Minute Med Check. A Brief History of Mental Illness Diagnoses and Treatments. The first known use of head shrinker as a slang term for a psychotherapist appeared in the November 27, 1950 issue of Time magazine, which asserted that anyone who had predicted the phenomenal success of the television western Hopalong Cassidy would have been sent to a head shrinker. The article explained in a footnote that head shrinker is Hollywood slang for a psychiatrist. The head shrinker metaphor arguably reflects the feelings of fear, mystery, and hostility traditionally associated with the profession. Another theory holds that it implicitly refers to shrinking a patient's narcissistic, inflated sense of self. Although many mental health professionals have come to accept the term with self-deprecating humor, it has also been criticized as a relic of an outmoded therapeutic approach that reduces people to mere causes and symptoms rather than regarding them as complex individuals. When one person gets better, it can cause a cascade of help across generations of people. When I first met my wife, Tana, in 2006, I really, really liked her. Having been divorced for 6 years, I had told myself that before I ever married again, I would need to see the woman's brain scan before going to the next level. About 3 weeks after we met, I invited Tana to the clinic. She was a neurological intensive care nurse, and we bonded over our love of the brain, so it wasn't that weird. Her brain was beautiful, and 2.5 years later, we were married. Over the years, that one scan changed many other brains. A few months after Tana was scanned, a neurologist diagnosed Tana's estranged father with Alzheimer's disease. But when I scanned her dad, his SPECT scan showed that he did not have Alzheimer's disease, but rather depression, masquerading as it. We prescribed natural dietary supplements for him, and several months later, he was able to teach a 6-hour seminar at a local church. Then Tana's mother and uncle were fighting at work, so I evaluated and scanned them. It turned out that they both had terrible attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD. On medication, they got along much better, and their business improved. Then a friend of Tana's from her early 20s saw us on a public television show together and reached out to Tana because her son Jarrett was really struggling. Jarrett was diagnosed with ADHD in preschool. His mother said he was driven by a motor that was revved way too high. He was hyperactive, hyperverbal, restless, and impulsive, and he couldn't focus. But he also didn't sleep well and interrupted everyone all the time. He had no friends, his classmates avoided him, and their parents kept their children away from him. His third-grade teacher said he would never do well in school and cautioned his parents to lower their expectations. He had seen 5 doctors and was prescribed 5 stimulant medications for ADHD. All of them made Jarrett worse, triggering mood swings and terrible rages. He put holes in the walls of their home and scared his siblings. His behavior had gotten so bad that his last doctor wanted to put him on an antipsychotic medication. This is when his mother brought him to see us. Jarrett's brain SPECT scan clearly showed dramatic overactivity in a pattern we call the ring of fire. No wonder stimulants didn't work. It was like pouring gasoline on a fire. Our published research shows that stimulants make this pattern worse 80% of the time. On a group of natural supplements to calm his brain, together with parent training and structured brain-healthy habits, Jarrett's behavior dramatically improved. His grades went up, the rages stopped, and he was able to make friends. He has now been on the honor roll for 8 straight years. After searching for so long, his parents are grateful to have found the correct treatment plan for him, which has completely altered the course of his life. There is no telling what the future would have held for Jarrett if he had stayed on his previous path. How would Jarrett have been treated throughout history? The word psychiatry originates from the medieval Latin psychiatria, meaning healing of the soul. Many societies have viewed mental illness as a form of divine punishment or demon possession. This chapter will walk you through history to show you some of the strange and unsettling things that would have been prescribed in an attempt to heal Jarrett. Ancient civilization. In ancient Indian, Egyptian, Greek, and Roman writings, mental illness was often seen as a religious or personal failure. As early as 6500 BC, prehistoric skulls and cave art showed evidence of trepanation, a surgical procedure that involved drilling or scraping a hole in the skull to release evil spirits thought to be trapped inside. Treatment? Religious leaders may have attempted an exorcism for Jarrett or drilled a hole in his skull to release the evil spirits. Trepanation, to allow trapped evil spirits to escape. Hippocrates. The Greek physician Hippocrates, 460 to 370 BC, believed all mental illnesses came from the brain. He wrote, "Men ought to know that from the brain, and from the brain only, arise our pleasures, joy, laughter, and jests, as well as our sorrows, pains, despondency, and tears. And by the same organ, we become mad and delirious, where fears and terrors assail us. All these things we endure from the brain when it is not healthy." Recognized as the father of medicine, Hippocrates proposed one of the first classifications of mental disorders, including mania, melancholy, phrenitis, brain inflammation, fever, delirium, insanity, disobedience, paranoia, panic, epilepsy, and hysteria. Some of those terms are still used today. The renowned physician did not view mental illness as shameful. He believed that mentally ill people were not responsible for their behavior and advocated that their family care for them at home. He was a pioneer in treating mentally ill people with more rational techniques, focusing on changing a person's diet, environment, or occupation, and adding medications, exercise, music, art therapy, and even divine solicitation. It's incredible to consider that nearly 2,500 years ago, Hippocrates was already suggesting that mental illnesses should be treated as physical medical illnesses and treated with lifestyle changes, the main point of this book. However, he also theorized that physical and medical illnesses were caused by an imbalance of 4 essential bodily fluids or humors: blood, yellow bile, black bile, and phlegm, which is partly to blame for the practices of bloodletting and purging, similar to taking laxatives to empty the bowels. Treatment. Likely Hippocrates would have had Jarrett exercise, listen to music, create art, and focus on an occupation that fit his restless nature. He may have also bled him to release excess blood and had him take some natural supplements. Galen. Galen, AD 130 to 201. Another Greek physician during the Roman Empire, and ultimately one of the most influential physicians in history, agreed with Hippocrates' four-humor theory of illness and associated them to four temperaments. Sanguine. Blood, extroverted, social, risk-taking. Phlegmatic. Phlegm, relaxed, peaceful, easygoing. Choleric. Yellow bile. Take charge, decisive, goal-oriented. Melancholic, black bile, creative, kind, and introverted. Like Hippocrates, Galen believed no difference existed between mental and physical illness and noted that psychological stress could cause mental health issues. He is credited with the development of a tripartite theory of the soul, attempting to localize where the three parts were housed in the body: rational, brain; spiritual, heart; and appetitive, liver. In his book, On the Diagnosis and Cure of the Soul's Passion, Galen discussed how to treat psychological problems, which some have called an early attempt at psychotherapy. He directed people with psychological issues to share their deepest passions and secrets, which can help them feel better. Treatment. Galen would have prescribed Jared a treatment plan similar to Hippocrates, with the addition of talk therapy. Middle Ages. By the Middle Ages, supernatural explanations of mental illnesses resurfaced in Europe in an attempt to explain natural disasters such as plagues and famines. In the 13th century, mentally ill people, especially females, were treated as demon-possessed witches. In the 16th century, Dutch physician Johan Weyer and Englishman Reginald Scott tried to persuade their populations that those accused of witchcraft were actually people with mental illnesses in need of help, but the Catholic Church's Inquisition banned their writings. This practice did not decline until the 17th and 18th centuries. In the largest set of witch trials in America, between February 1692 to May 1693, more than 200 people were accused of being witches in Salem, Massachusetts. 20 were executed, 14 females and 6 males, and others died in prison. In the 16th and 17th centuries, asylums were created to house the mentally ill against their will. Inmates, many of whom were chained and beaten, often lived in squalor. Sometimes they were even exhibited to those willing to pay a fee. They were also subjected to a host of arcane medical practices, such as purging, blistering, or bloodletting. Treatment. Religious leaders may have attempted an exorcism on Jarrett, or physicians may have placed him in an asylum, where he would have been blistered, bled, or given laxatives. 18th and 19th centuries. In 1789, King George III of England descended into madness. His doctors were unable to say if he would recover or if someone else should replace him. This crisis triggered physicians at England's insane asylums to begin looking into the inheritance patterns of mental illness. Long before the discovery of DNA, doctors started collecting family histories of the insane, criminals, and those with intellectual disabilities among those in the asylums, prisons, and schools for feeble-minded children. At the time, physicians who specialized in mental illness were called alienists because they treated people who were alienated from society. Some alienists thought stress caused mental illness, but most ascribed to the belief that it was transmitted through families by heredity. Asylum directors started using family trees and surveys to study and track down affected relatives of their patients and institutionalized them as well, believing these people should be discouraged from reproducing. Asylum superintendents, legislators, and social reformers embarked on a deeply misguided eugenics movement to improve society by passing sterilization laws that were eventually supported by the U.S. Supreme Court. 1927, Buck versus Bell case. They passed in 32 states and form part of the rationale for Nazi Germany's atrocities. This movement continued into the 1960s, with more than 60,000 Americans undergoing sterilization. In 18th century Europe, protests broke out over the conditions in the asylums, and reformers aimed to end the abusive practices. They took the patients out of chains and encouraged good hygiene, recreation, and occupational training. In the United States, one of the signers of the Declaration of Independence, physician Benjamin Rush, who is considered the father of American psychiatry, established a more benevolent approach, unshackling patients, forbidding beatings, and lobbying for improved living conditions in Pennsylvania. This doesn't mean that all of Rush's therapies were helpful. In his book, Medical Inquiries and Observations Upon the Diseases of the Mind, he wrote that hypochondriasis, a form of melancholia or modern-day depression, needed to be treated by direct and drastic interferences that involved assaulting the patient's mind and body in an attempt to reset their constitution. He recommended that doctors plumb patients' systems by bleeding, leeches, blistering, and cupping, similar to the current cupping trend that reached national attention when swimmer Michael Phelps was spotted at the 2016 Olympics with the telltale purple blotches on his back that arise from the treatment. Rush also prescribed drugs like mercury, arsenic, and strychnine, now known to be poisonous, to induce vomiting and diarrhea, and suggested fasting for 2 or 3 days. Once the body was cleaned out, he recommended stimulants such as tea and coffee, ginger and black pepper in large doses, magnesia, mustard rubs, hot baths to induce sweating, followed by cold baths and exercise. When Abraham Lincoln was severely depressed in January 1841, his physician, Dr. Anson Henry, subscribed to Rush's aggressive theories and likely subjected the future president to these punishing treatments. After Lincoln spent a week alone with Dr. Henry, he described himself as the most miserable man living. Rush also believed many psychiatric illnesses were the result of blocked circulation. To improve brain blood flow in schizophrenic patients, Rush would strap them into the gyrating chair, a device that spun them around until they became dizzy. It didn't work. In the 1770s, Europe was influenced by German physician Franz Anton Mesmer, who attempted to treat the energy blockages he believed were at the root of mental illness. He thought all illnesses could be attributed to an insufficient flow of what he called animal magnetism. By putting patients into a trance-like state and then probing certain body parts to restore energy flow, Mesmer drove his patients to states of crisis, delirium, or seizures. In some patients, symptoms miraculously vanished after the treatment, rocketing Mesmer to celebrity status. In 1843, Scottish physician James Braid coined the term hypnosis for a technique originally derived from animal magnetism to induce hypnotic trances. Treatment. Jarrett may have been institutionalized and sterilized, if not euthanized, and his family placed under suspicion. American physician Rush might have prescribed blistering and poisonous drugs like arsenic, followed by hot and cold baths. Germany's Mesmer might have hypnotized Jarrett to relieve the blockage of energy. Freud, and psychoanalysis. In the late 19th century, Viennese physician Sigmund Freud voyaged to Salpêtrière Hospital in Paris, where he studied with the founder of modern neurology, Jean-Martin Charcot, who is best known for his work with hysteria and hypnosis. Charcot used hypnosis as a cathartic energy release to enable healing. Freud later abandoned hypnosis in favor of psychoanalysis, the talking cure, which dominated psychiatry for the first half of the 20th century. Freud, a neurologist, was determined to understand the human mind. He tried to understand it from a neuroscience or brain perspective, but gave up in 1895 when he concluded that the science of his time was not up to the task of explaining patients' symptoms. Eventually, he came to believe in the power of the subconscious, which could not be accessed during wakefulness, but could be accessed in hypnotic trances and later through psychoanalysis. For Freud, the mind was like an iceberg. The largest part was unconscious and hidden from sight. He argued that the mind had three parts. One, the id, child self, selfish desires and instincts. Two, ego, adult self, that helps control the id to make more rational decisions. And three, superego, moral self, that is the voice in your head judging your actions. He developed the talking cure of psychoanalysis to help rid mentally ill patients of their internal conflicts between their id, ego, and superego, which he viewed as the cause of many mental illnesses. For example, if a man wants to steal from his employer, id, he may sublimate the desire by writing crime stories or deny the desire altogether. But what if these defense mechanisms, sublimation and denial, are not strong enough? Freud hypothesized the person may develop a psychiatric disorder. By encouraging people to talk about their hidden fears and desires, Freud believed he could lead them to a cure. He encouraged his patients to talk about everything that came to mind, including their dreams. Then he would psychoanalyze them. He believed many conflicts typically started in childhood. Psychoanalysis provided the launching pad for hundreds of schools of psychotherapy and talking cures still in existence today, including behavior therapy, cognitive behavioral therapy, psychodynamic therapy, and marital, family, and group therapy. Treatment. Freud may have had Jarrett lying on the psychiatrist's couch four or five times a week, attempting to work out his internal conflicts. Krepelin and the biological causes of mental illness. A contemporary of Freud's, German psychiatrist Emil Krepelin, believed the primary cause of mental illness was biological, with a strong genetic component. His theories were influential during the early 20th century and reemerged at the end of the 20th century when psychoanalysis fell out of favor. Viewing psychiatry as a branch of medicine, he began developing the modern classification system for mental disorders. He also protested against the inhumane treatments in psychiatric asylums and argued against alcoholism and capital punishment. He emerged as an advocate for the treatment rather than the imprisonment of the insane and rejected Freud's psychoanalytical theories as unscientific, especially those suggesting that early sexual urges were the cause of mental illness. Treatment. Krepelin would have diagnosed Jarrett with a brain that was misfiring and attempted to find a biological cure. Early 20th century. Fever, insulin shock, ECT, and lobotomy cures. Austrian physician Julius Wagner-Jauregg experimented with curing psychosis by inducing fevers. Misguided, he infected his patients with a byproduct of the bacteria that causes tuberculosis. It was not successful. Undeterred, he began to use malaria parasites in 1917 to treat psychotic patients suffering from syphilis. 15% of them died, and the rest contracted malaria, but the fevers did temporarily decrease their symptoms. Wagner Jareg was awarded the Nobel Prize for his research in 1927. In 1927, another Austrian psychiatrist, Manfred Zackel, administered large doses of insulin to purposely cause seizures in psychotic patients. Researchers discovered that if blood glucose levels went too low, people fell into a coma or experienced seizures, and this could temporarily alleviate symptoms. Unfortunately, the treatment was associated with negative side effects, such as obesity, and more severe consequences, including brain damage and even death. In 1938, Italian neurologists Ugo Cerletti and Lucino Bini were the first to deliver electric shocks to patients to induce seizures. They found that electroconvulsive therapy, ECT, had more lasting benefits than insulin shock therapy with fewer side effects. ECT is still used today to treat severe cases of schizophrenia, depression, mania, and serious suicidal thoughts. With anesthesia, muscle relaxants, and more targeted dosing, it can be an effective technique, but it can also cause memory problems, confusion, headaches, and muscle aches. In 1935, Portuguese neurologist Antonio Egas Muniz drilled holes into the skulls of 20 mentally disturbed patients and used a wire in 13 of them to sever the connections in the brain's frontal lobes. Muniz was hoping the procedure, called a lobotomy, would calm his patients, who suffered from anxiety, depression, and schizophrenia. It worked. Patients became more compliant, spurring wide adoption of the procedure, which was subsequently used on thousands of patients. Over time, however, it became apparent that it destroyed personalities and turned people into zombie-like beings. Despite these alarming side effects, Muniz also received a Nobel Prize for his work. Treatment. Wagner Jareg would have given Jarrett malaria in an attempt to heal him. Zackel would have tried insulin shock therapy on Jarrett. Cerletti and Bini would have subjected Jarrett to electric shock therapy to reset his brain. Muniz would have performed a frontal lobotomy on Jarrett, calming his aggression but permanently damaging his personality. Today, there is a renaissance of surgical techniques for psychiatric illnesses, but they are very different from the frontal lobotomy of old. Very precise, non-damaging surgical interventions can be used to turn off or on certain circuits in the brain. This approach has been effective in Parkinson's disease and has shown some efficacy for obsessive-compulsive disorder, OCD, and some patients with refractory depression. The late 20th century, the mind medication revolution. Despite psychoanalysis and the other techniques listed above, there was little hope for a cure for serious mental illnesses until the 1950s, when a host of psychiatric medications became available to practitioners and patients. The first effective medication for schizophrenia, chlorpromazine, brand name Thorazine, was developed in 1951 to treat nausea and allergies and to calm patients before surgery. When it was administered to a hospitalized, violent young man, it immediately calmed him and caused such an improvement in his behavior, he was discharged a few weeks later. Chlorpromazine and subsequently other antipsychotic medications, which reportedly block excessive dopamine in the brain, led to dramatic improvements for many psychotic patients and ultimately to a significant reduction in state hospital populations. The 1950s also saw the release of methylphenidate, Ritalin, which soon was prescribed to help hyperactive children. Chlorodiazepoxide, Librium, the first benzodiazepine for anxiety disorders, and enipramine, tofranil, for severe depression. The age of psychopharmacology had begun in earnest with medications for bipolar disorder, OCD, and other disorders flooding the market in the decades that followed. While I was in medical school, Xanax was released for panic disorders with the erroneous notion that it was less addictive than Librium and other benzodiazepines. Since it was new, psychiatric residents prescribed it a lot, which is something I later regretted when I saw what it did to SPECT scans. Plus, whenever I prescribed it to patients, I found it was incredibly hard for them to get off it. In 1987, with the FDA approval of the blockbuster antidepressant Prozac, fluoxetine, the mind drug revolution began to dominate psychiatry. Reportedly, Prozac had fewer side effects than enipramine and medications like it, leading to other selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor SSRIs antidepressant medications being approved for depression. Since Prozac was introduced, antidepressant use in the United States has increased 400%, and more than 1 in 10 Americans now takes one. Only medications to lower cholesterol are prescribed more often than antidepressants in the United States. After the global success of Prozac, the chemical imbalance theory of mental illness burst into the public consciousness, and many people began proactively asking their doctors to fix their down moods. Famously, after actress Carrie Fisher was cremated, her ashes were placed in a green and white Prozac pill-shaped urn. Since Prozac was introduced, antidepressant use in the United States has increased 400%, and more than 1 in 10 Americans now takes one. Taking pills may seem like an easier and quicker solution to bad moods than taking the time and effort to develop brain-healthy habits, build skills, or change troublesome behavior. Yet there is a dark side to the mind meds that is often overlooked. Thousands of lawsuits claim that Prozac and other psychiatric medications increase violent or suicidal behavior. Virtually all antidepressants and antipsychotic medications have black box warnings, which, in simple terms, means the FDA cautions patients in the strongest terms to pay close attention to potentially extremely harmful or dangerous threats to their health. In 1991, just when I was beginning to use brain SPECT imaging, reports surfaced suggesting Prozac increased violent behavior. When it happened to one of my patients, it horrified me. It caused us to start reviewing scans to see if we could predict which scan patterns were associated with medications making patients worse, such as the negative reaction Jarrett had on multiple stimulants. We have published papers on ADD/ADHD and depression, revealing the SPECT patterns that are associated with both positive and negative responses to medications. Despite the problems, the pharmaceutical industry is incredibly successful at marketing psychiatric medications to doctors and the general public. From 1997 to 2016, the industry increased direct-to-consumer prescription drug advertising from $1.3 billion to $6 billion. Prescription drug ads often did not adequately explain side effects, and because of repeated exposure, many people tune out those statements at the end of TV commercials, often delivered in a rapid-fire manner, such as, "This drug may cause permanent liver damage, seizures, and allergic reaction that leads to fatal throat swelling and suicidal tendencies." Patients in the United States are more than twice as likely to ask for drugs seen in ads compared with those in Canada, where most direct-to-consumer advertising is prohibited. There is no doubt in my mind that psychiatric medication saves lives, especially for people who have the more serious brain health/mental health disorders, such as bipolar disorder and schizophrenia. Yet we should all be cautious with meds because once they are started, they are hard to stop. And they do not just reset your brain, they change it. An Oxford University study found most SSRIs, such as Prozac, Paxil, Zoloft, and Lexapro, do not just decrease negative emotions, they reduce all emotions, including love, happiness, and joy. Participants felt separated from their surroundings and cared less about important things in their daily lives. They felt like their personalities had changed. Treatment. Even though Jared had failed 5 prescription medications before seeing us, other doctors would continue the trial and error method of trying to get his symptoms under control. The DSM. A more scientific approach? In an effort to adopt a more objective and scientific approach and to increase standardization in a field that struggled with credibility, in 1952, the American Psychiatric Association, APA, released the first version of the Diagnostic and Structural Manual of Mental Disorders, DSM-1. Which categorized all mental disorders. Initially modeled after diagnostic tools used by the military and Veterans Association, the DSM has since undergone revisions, resulting in 5 subsequent editions. DSM-2, 1968, DSM-3, 1980, DSM-3R, 1987, DSM-4, 1994, and DSM-5, 2013. The DSM has had great success, and nearly all mental health professionals in the United States and many around the world use it. Yet it is not without controversy. In a 2005 lecture at the annual meeting of the APA, Thomas Insel, one of the most powerful psychiatrists in the world, at the time as director of the National Institutes of Mental Health, caused an uproar when he announced the DSM was 100% reliable, but 0% valid. Meaning, if you make a diagnosis with the criteria today for a certain disorder like depression, you will make it again tomorrow, but 0% valid because it is not based on any underlying neuroscience. After the DSM-5 was introduced in 2013, Insel posted a blog. "The goal of this new manual, as with all previous editions, is to provide a common language for describing psychopathology. While DSM has been described as a Bible for the field, it is, at best, a dictionary, creating a set of labels and defining each. The strength of each of the editions of DSM has been reliability. Each edition has ensured that clinicians use the same terms in the same ways. The weakness is its lack of validity. Unlike our definitions of ischemic heart disease, lymphoma, or AIDS, the DSM diagnoses are not based on any objective laboratory measure. Patients with mental disorders deserve better." After using a number of the DSM versions on thousands of patients over the past 40 years, it is clear to me that it can help us categorize illnesses such as depression, bipolar disorder, schizophrenia, panic disorder, or borderline personality disorder. But it doesn't tell us anything about what causes them or how to predict which treatments will work because, as Insel suggested, it is not based on any underlying neuroscience. What's more, each new version of the DSM adds additional mental disorders, which leads to an increase in the number of people diagnosed with problems, a concept called medicalization, where in a given year, about 1 in 5 Americans will suffer from at least one DSM disorder. Contrast that with rates from the 1950s, wherein far fewer people were being diagnosed each year. The more disorders that are included in the DSM, and the more lenient their definitions, the easier it is to diagnose healthy people as having a problem. Predictably, the increase in sick people correlates with an increase in treatment, especially medications. Treatment. Jarrett had been diagnosed with DSM-4, ADHD, since the age of 3, but none of the standard medications recommended had worked. In fact, they all made him worse. The 15-minute med check. When I was in training in the late 1970s to mid-1980s, psychiatrists were able to spend time with patients. If patients needed to be hospitalized, psychiatrists could treat and stabilize them over weeks or months. In outpatient settings, psychiatrists performed both psychotherapy and medication management, often seeing patients 1 or 2 times a week. In the early 1990s, when managed health care became popular, insurance companies began to dictate how long patients can stay in the hospital and how many sessions they could have with therapists. Having been in the trenches at the time, it seemed to me that many of their decisions were based not on patient need, but on attempts to optimize company profits. Over the years, professionals have been squeezed to see more patients in less time in order to make enough money.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.